This is kind of a weird test, dudes.
What do you mean?
Well, I'm trying to answer a question that nobody has really asked. How does temperature in the coolant and the intake manifold affect performance, and what can you do about it?
And we all know that's the way to cheat on the dyno.
Not cheating, it's optimizing.
Optimizing?
Oh, okay, I'm sorry, Steve. I didn't mean to offend you there.
That's right.
So I think the first test we're going to do is run the thing cold coolant temperature and then run it hot coolant temperature and then look at data. We know it's going to lose power, but I want to find out why.
Well, first of all, it's carbureted. So we're going to see some latent vaporization and temperature drop in the intake manifold, unlike fuel injection where you're seeing kind of this constant air temp throughout the whole intake manifold.
So you and I have bench traced this a lot, so I have to ask Dulcich, why do you think an engine makes less power at heat?
Air density.
Where?
On the induction side of the intake valve.
So you think at 190 degrees, the air in the intake manifold is going to be hotter than it would be if the coolant temperature was 125 degrees?
I think so.
Okay.
What do you think?
So Holdner first said it, and then you backed it up, that the air temperature in the intake manifold is not going to change with coolant temperature. And I've thought about that and thought about that and thought about that and didn't believe it, but I'm sort of coming around to it. But this is the test that's actually, I think, going to prove it. And he's done it before. So I say we just run it. And
yeah, it's going to be some pretty interesting stuff, I think.
Yeah. Okay, so our first run here is going to be with our 598 at a cold coolant temperature, and we haven't altered the temperature of the room or the intake manifold at all. Let's have a look at our power peaks and then dive into some of the temperature numbers. Wow, we just made 790 pound-feet of torque, and it made 854.8 horsepower. And look at this thing, it's 700 pound-feet from the hit. Okay, so that's our baseline power number, but let's have a look at what the temperatures are telling us. The air in the intake runner started at 76, which is really close to room temperature, a little bit less, and then got cooler and cooler and cooler as we went. And it's not affected by wind chill factor. It's reading actual just temperature.
Well, there's more fuel with more air there because at idle, there's still a lot of air movement banging around with the air, which causes some heat.
And we have to give Troy credit. It's overlap.
We're sitting here and Troy goes, yeah. What about the overlap at idle?
Yeah.
Because there's all this,
yeah.
and we both looked at Troy and went, wow.
Pork chop for the win.
So the air during the overlap cycle is coming back up and hitting this sensor. As engine speed increases, there's less reversion and still the vaporization and cooling. There's still a difference there, and the air does heat up.
So let me summarize. We're looking at the temperatures in the room, under the carburetor, and in the intake runner. In the room, we were looking at 79 degrees. Under the carburetor, while the thing was running wide open at peak horsepower, it was 43 to 44 degrees. And in the runner, we saw 68 degrees. And so it got hotter from underneath the carburetor than it did in the runner. And our belief in that is because the air speed is the molecules rubbing into each other and actually causing heat because of friction.
Yeah.
So that's sort of the nutshell of what we just decided, right?
I'm with you.
I agree.
And so once again, this is wide open throttle testing. Things would be different at part throttle cruising around. So the next thing to do is to heat this thing up to 200 degrees of coolant temp and see if it gets worse.